Can you hear me? So now we've got around 30 minutes for Q&A, for questions and answers, especially for Eric Evans and Yuri. So if you have any questions, please go ahead. I can let you do mic, or if you don't want to, I mean, you could speak in Spanish and I can also repeat the question if you want, or just do it in English, as you want. So who's first?
Hello. My first question is for Eric. In domain-driven design, the book, you talk about modeling. And how does domain-driven design relate to practices like TDD or refactoring, where you actually remodel or correct the model after you have a working implementation? What is the balance between upfront modeling and modeling from experience?
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. So I think, first of all, I'm not a fan of upfront modeling. I think you have to do enough modeling at the beginning to have some concept on which to base your initial design. So I might spend a week on upfront modeling. Maybe 2 weeks if it were a new project where we were really starting from scratch and we needed to get some kind of traction. But not any longer than that, or not much. And I think things like TDD and refactoring are perfectly compatible with domain-driven design. But remember what I say is the model isn't a UML diagram or something. It's the set of concepts, it's the system of abstraction that is behind what you're doing. So if you write some code, you're expressing some set of concepts. And the way you name things and the kind of rules that those things follow, that is an expression of the model, or it should be. So when you refactor, maybe you're doing your refactoring in this very mechanical way. Oh, I see duplication, so I'm going to extract something. And I don't like that too much. I mean, well, sometimes you look and you just say, well, this is just messy, and I just need to do some mechanical refactoring to just clean it up a little bit. But sometimes when you're refactoring, you're saying the concept isn't quite right, and I'm going to modify the concept. And when that time comes, I want to pause long enough to think about, well, what is the concept? Why is it not fulfilling my scenario very well? What is the concept I'd like to arrive at? And then refactor to that. So in my book, there's a section called Refactoring Toward Deeper Insight. And that's what I like to do. I think of refactoring as part of the cycle of modeling. And you keep going deeper, you change the code, and you change the way you think about the code. And then you change the code some more, and you think about it. So I don't see these things in conflict at all. But people do make TDD very mechanical. And they do make refactoring very mechanical. Everyone's always trying to make these things make us into machines that will just respond to these mechanical clues. But if you just say, well, this is a refactoring is a way that I can change the implementation of a working piece of software, then of course, whenever you change your idea about what the model should be, what do you need to do? You need to change the code. You don't really want to change the, so that's my answer to that one.
I'll just add a little bit to that. I mean, when Martin wrote the book about refactoring, a very big part of it was you have to retain the system's behavior. If you're changing the system's behavior, by definition, you're not refactoring. Mm. So whenever you're talking about, I've uncovered a new concept, or the old concept that I had wasn't quite right, I need a new concept, you're not refactoring, you're doing design. Now, often when you're doing that, when you realize that you have the wrong concept, a lot of your tests become, I'm not sure if I'd use the word irrelevant, but they're testing the wrong type of behavior, because now you're saying the system shouldn't behave like X, it should behave like Y. Your goal is not to retain the functioning of those tests. So there's nothing wrong with TDD and refactoring as, let's call it, programming practices. And TDD can help you drive the, let's call it, the low-level design once you know what the high-level concepts are. But a very big part of what Eric talks about is, well, uncovering what the high-level concept should have been. So you can kind of look at it as sort of a cadence of doing higher level design and then going down. And as you mentioned this morning, you said, you know, sometimes when you go down, you realize that there's something missing from your high level concept. And then you cadence back up and do a little bit more high level design until you're more or less happy with this new place that you're at. And then you go back down, you might do some more TDD and some refactoring. So like you said, not as a phased of how much do I do up front, but as a activity that I do throughout the entire process.
Yeah, let me follow up on that again. The term cadence strikes me as about right. You know, you're kind of shifting between these different modes of thought. Another thing about tests is that the TDE people are very focused on a test as sort of proving correctness. So I find that when I'm working, I write a lot of tests, upfront tests, that is test first, that are not probably, they wouldn't be TDD approved because they aren't trying to cover edge cases or anything. What they really are is that I find that that writing, say, an N-unit test or a J-unit test is a great place to explore my design sort of from a client-side view. You know, if you just look at, say you're building objects, and you're just looking at the object implementation, and you see it from the inside out. But when you write a kind of a test, you kind of are bringing one of those scenarios to life, an actual example, bringing it to life and saying, well, how would I say that in my model conceptual terms?
And then how would I handle this command?
How would I handle this command? For example, suppose we were doing CQRS, then it would be very command-centric. Suppose I had a set of commands like these, not just one, but mm-hmm. What if these people wanted all their crazy different things? What would the answer be? And then I have an assertion. But it lets me think through this, and then I have, now that test though, see, that's not one of the comprehensive tests that's going to prove that, yeah, I've thought of every edge case and all that. It's more of the exploratory phase. I do a lot of that actually. And I usually do it in the unit test framework, even though what I'm doing is not really a unit test.
I'm sorry, I don't speak English very well, so I will speak in Spanish.
La pregunta, era una para Eric relacionada con si existe alguna herramienta, aparte del Entity Framework, como hemos visto, que permita diseñar un modelo de dominio y generar código total o parcialmente a partir de él. Mm-hmm. Y la otra pregunta era para Judy relacionada
con. So the first question is for Eric. It is related to modeling, and the question is there any tool where you can create a model and it will generate the whole thing for you? I think you might be talking about MDD, model-driven design, related to DDD or something like that.
Yeah, so so these approaches, I don't use them myself, so I haven't approached things with that. It's not that they are inconsistent with domain-driven design. I think what people are trying to do, what they're really groping for, is a higher level language. They want to have a place where they can express some model concept more explicitly, instead of the way we have to do it in Java, where we more or less procedurally approximate a statement about the model. So I sympathize with that goal. And at their best, these techniques actually do let you say something. Some of them, I think, really get in the way, though, because they are very heavy, sort of, well, they're just so heavy. And also, I don't think UML, everyone has focused so much on UML. I don't think UML is really that good a language for programming. I think the original conception of UML was a communication technique between people. So I think if we let go of some of those things, that the idea of having some expressions saying some things about the model, and then this would be generated or automatically enforced in the code, I think that would be good. I think it really belongs at the programming language level, but if it has to be in a framework, that could be good. I haven't used it very much, though. I like to, there's something about the, I prefer to be in the programming language. Those things somehow get in the way as often as they help for me. So I'm not speaking from principle here, I'm just talking about, mm-hmm. The kind of practical trade-off.
So in my opinion, regarding this topic, like MDD or model-driven design, where you create a model visually and then that's it, it's going to be the program. I think it's kind of too early nowadays. at least what I know, it's not flexible enough as while you are programming code. I mean, you see Entity Framework, it's just for the almost data and entities, and it's not for the whole program. And regarding DDD, it is better code first, writing code instead of the visual graphics. So, and also another good example or bad example from Microsoft is if you know a project called Oslo, that was kind of MDD project, a lot of investment in that, and at last Microsoft gave up. Maybe they will use it for several things, but not as the initial idea, which was very MDD.
Any other question?
Tenía una pregunta para Uri, referente a que por lo que tengo entendido, que QRS se utiliza para aplicaciones con muchísimos usuarios. Quería saber más o menos en qué orden de magnitud estamos hablando. Claro, dependerá de la aplicación, dependerá de lo que se haga, del tipo de aplicación, pero ¿qué estamos hablando? ¿De 1,000 usuarios, 10,000, 10,000, 1,000,000 usuarios concurrentes? ¿Un orden?
Okay, so the question is for Yuri regarding CQRS. Mm-hmm. And so CQRS is usually, it fits quite well for high scalable apps where and also collaborative and several scenarios. And the question is, okay, if we're talking about an application where we need this high scalability, but how much? Are we talking about hundreds of users concurrent or thousands or kind of, where do you put the limit?
Are you talking about the upper limit or the lower limit?
I think you
well, maybe both.
Sounded like lower limit.
No,
the lower limit.
Yeah. Upper is
right. So usually it's not the choice to use CQRS is not based on numbers of current users or scale or a lot of the traditional non-functional requirements. I prefer to look at CQRS as a question-centric approach rather than an answer-centric approach. In other words, what are the kinds of questions that you ask business stakeholders in order to uncover what it is that they care about? What is the user intent? in the reservation system example, my intention is to book 5 seats sitting together for me and my family. Now, whether that's in this specific row or 2 rows forwards or 3 rows backwards, that statement is true even if I'm talking about a movie theater or if I'm talking about a football stadium. Now, the fact that these solutions scale very well, I look at that as a side effect, not as the reason to do it to begin with. So, say, capturing user intent, solving the real business problem, these are all good things that we're trying to do. Now, a lot of times when people say, okay, let's say I'm not in a collaborative domain, they view the alternative to CQRS as being the traditional 3-tier architecture. Right? Say that it's probably overkill as well. In other words, if CQRS isn't applicable, then it's very likely that you're talking about a user that's operating only on their own data. I'd say that probably a 2-tier Ruby on Rails style of approach, where what you see on the UI and the data that's stored in the database is 1-to-1, and you don't have any DTOs, and you don't have a domain model, and you don't, you know, just get rid of all of those layers. So I'd say it's a 2-tier, 2-layer, you know, old school client server architecture is probably the alternative. If we're looking at, say, in the Amazon.com example, the bounded context that's responsible for a product's name, its image, its description. This is very simple data, not very much logic around it. All you need to do is to grab it from the UI, store it to a database, and show it later. So why add view models and data transfer objects and domain models and all of these other layers? The business doesn't seem to be asking for it. So I'd say in many cases, when you see that CQRS isn't necessary, you can throw out probably 90% of the complexity in traditional software and just go to a much simpler type of model. But again, it's not based on numbers of concurrent users or requests per second or a lot of those non-functional requirements. It's often based on the business problem that you're trying to solve.
Any other?
I'd like to know how you feel about domain-specific languages. Are they worth the effort?
Is that both of us, or?
Yes, for both.
Eric, you want to go first?
I'll go first.
So are they worth the effort? Well, that's easy. The answer is it depends.
I agree with him.
But for those of you that are consultants, it's important to know that it depends. You don't get to put a period after it depends. It depends, comma, and then you have to include the rest of it. So it depends, comma. Domain-specific languages require a very high level of skill of the team that's building them, because not only is it not enough for the team to be able to understand the domain, they need to be skilled in composing languages. And that is very difficult. So think about designing an API, okay? And designing a good API, whether it's something like the base class library in .NET. It took a huge amount of skill for those people to come up with a very good, complete structure that was learnable by more junior developers while being flexible and extensible enough for senior developers to do what they needed to do in more edge cases. Now, that's in a technological domain in which everybody has a fairly good understanding because we've been doing this technology stuff for a while. When you're talking about a domain-specific language, junior developers, their understanding of the domain is not a subset of what the senior developers understand. So you can't take the traditional view of, well, I'll just have a much smaller API that junior developers will work against, and they'll be able to be able to deliver functionality. And even being able to think as a language designer, which constructs am I going to create, and what are the various layers of those constructs so that people can build larger concepts from them. It's, when you asked, is it worth it? I don't think necessarily people understand the effort to get to high level of quality. Now, to turn that around, someone would say, so what you're saying is that they're not worth it most of the time. And I'd say that that's a little bit of an overgeneralization, because, again, getting back to the bounded context example, you're not necessarily trying to come up with a DSL for your entire system and all elements of it. What you're looking for is those elements where DSL would be useful. Now, if we're talking about the product catalog story, an image name, description, image, DSL is practically worthless over there. So the time spent investing in what's that DSL going to look like, not going to have a very high return on investment. When you're talking about areas that often sit more as a core domain element, where the business intends to derive a whole lot of value out of it, there's a little bit of a, you know, two scenarios. One of them is if you're in a mature domain where a DSL might be useful because it could be stable, it might be worth the effort. The problem is, as Eric has often mentioned before, core domains tend to be the ones that change very often. So the problem that you have is that by virtue of them changing often, the time that it would have taken you to recoup the investment on coming up with a good DSL, you often don't have that time. So I'd say that if you're looking at, again, more mature domains where a lot of the what we do has already been figured out, say that that would be a place where DSL might be useful. But then the question is, well, is it really... is it so much better than the alternative? In other words, if we already know what the answer is, because the domain itself is mature, and because it's not changing very much, then we don't need a huge amount of flexibility, then maybe its value is questionable even there. So I'd say that in any of the business domain DSL style areas, I'd say the it depends falls on more often on the side of probably not. I'd say for a lot of technological domains where the problem is well defined enough, a small single purpose technological DSL might have some value. And you could look at unit testing frameworks as an example of a kind of DSL. User interface type of scenarios, again, you know, XAML as a kind of DSL, where those kind of places ended up helping out a lot, but they tend to have a very large asymmetry between the size of the people that are building the DSL and the population that is using it, right? If you're building a unit testing framework, the population potentially using this is almost all the developers on that platform. Same thing with the UI type of environment. So you, in order to get those benefits, you need some kind of very large multiple of users that are using it. Most companies don't tend to have that internally. Even large companies tend to have the development groups partitioned by business unit and whatnot. You don't often tend to have one core infrastructure team that is serving thousands of developers. There are some of those companies, but they're more rare. That'd be my complete answer to DSLs.
Well, I agree pretty much with that, and I wouldn't add a whole lot to it. I'm probably not quite as skeptical as Udi about the applicability of DSLs, but I think it's better to be, you know, to be skeptical. I can think of cases where I've seen clearly, for example, when you have a device, you know, and they've got some kind of embedded programming language in the device, That's a DSL. And that's clearly a winning case. It's a case where you're not going to need to change the language because it's pretty much it's a representation of what this device can do and your options there. I've seen for example, some factory automation things where those very complex, you know, the robots and so forth, they have their own programming language that is accessible to the engineers who work in those factories. The engineers in the factory doesn't have to understand how the robot works inside. He knows he can make it do certain things. But as far as applicability to the business goes, there's a more limited range. I'm working with a client right now where they're trying to model these very complex deals between their vendors, and so they're kind of a wholesaler. They buy stuff from the manufacturers, they sell stuff to retail outlets. Based on all sorts of arbitrarily complicated rules that are written into the contracts, they get a bonus from the manufacturer for certain volumes of certain products that they manage to sell and distribute and so forth, exempting certain kinds of customers. And it's as I said, it's arbitrarily complex. So these are all written down as there's actually paper contracts. Well, they're actually like documents in the computer, but they're just text, dumb text. And so they need the system to be able to interpret this. So now, we've considered a DSL for this purpose. Could you have a DSL that could express these arrangements? Well, you get this percentage under these circumstances, you know. And then it could basically crank out what the actual bonuses that you were entitled to based on an actual series of purchases and sales. But we ended up with something that wasn't really so DSL-like. It was the same concept, except that it was more of a composition of objects. So for each of these conditions that might apply, you know, well, a rate, okay, here's a rate object, and here are some conditions that apply to constrain the use of that rate. And when you display it, well, it looks almost like, you know, in the display it reads, sort of, but it's not put together by someone typing it in. It's put together by them picking pieces from menus and assembling. So it feels more like an assembly of parts. So it's more object-oriented, probably, than DSL-like. And I talk about the ubiquitous language all the time, but the way I think of it is probably a bit more abstract. And I think this is a place where I've maybe gotten even more, a little more skeptical. Because I used to say it seemed to me that DSL was a way to bring together the different forms that the ubiquitous language takes, the way we talk about the domain or the way we would write about it in a document versus the way we program. In the ideal, those two things would come together. But when you're actually doing it, then you face the rate of change issue. And these areas usually are, you know, you're exploring and experimenting. You want to write tests that express what you want the thing to do. But so, of course, I think in order for this to really be effective, you'd need all the suite of tools that we have for the programming languages to actually work on the DSLs. I need to be able to write tests that I could run against the things I wrote in the DSL. I'd need refactoring tools so that if we change our mind about what we want to call something, we can actually change the programs written in the DSL. We lack those tools, so it's hard for me to even judge how useful the concept would be if we really had a tool. Sometimes, you know, a tool set can be so powerful that an intrinsically superior approach might still not be as good because you're working with more primitive tools. So these things, I think, would also bias my decision. But I still find it an exciting idea, though. I must say, I hope that people keep experimenting in that area. I think there really is some potential there, but right now I would say the applications, the practical applications, are in relatively narrow, and I would largely agree with Udi summed up quite well, I think, the kind of areas you'd find most useful.
I think I have a question for both of you. It's how are the concepts of service in a service-oriented architecture and bounded context related, if they are related in any way?
Well, I'll go for this one. I think they are absolutely related, and I'll say what I think that relationship is. So one of the things that service-oriented architecture talks about is having this suite of services that people will use. And they talk about it as if a self-describing service could just be picked up and used by anybody. And I think that there is a deep logical thing missing there, that you can't interpret what things mean without context. And so what they're relying on is inferred context, like the kind of context that we use to understand each other when we're talking. And I don't think that's adequate. So if you view a service as just, you know, a thing which I can pass some numbers and strings into, and then some numbers and strings will come back, then fine, you know. I don't think that's what they were getting at. What they were getting at was that services are useful when they have meaning. You know, when you can say something meaningful to a service and get a meaningful response. And what gives things meaning is to have a clearly defined model within an explicit context, within some clearly defined context. So even though there might not be an object in sight, I think that the really well done service suites that I've seen tend to have a very clearly defined context boundary, or multiple ones. This set of services is interpreted with this very clearly defined conceptual model. All the terms mean something, very well defined. So I would call that a bounded context. This set of services where, you know, if they say customer means this. If they say route means this. And if there is very strict rules about how these things might be combined, those are consistent. And when you don't have that, then you either have services that are actually not very well defined, which you see quite a bit, you know, where definitions aren't clear, and so what you have to do is you just fiddle around until the thing works, and then you don't touch anything. So I know I've dealt with APIs and services that are like that, where you can get it to work by trial and error, and then you don't change it much. Or because you just got one little service that just sort of, you have to learn how to use that one, and then here's another one, and you have to learn how to use that one. But I think the best ones are little suites that are really a defined, bounded context. So that's my answer.
So one of the problems with service-oriented architecture is, just like with any other type of architecture, is that the term service is really not well defined. So you have undefined oriented architecture.
Do you have a definition of architecture?
Right. Because actually, there is. I was there in the early days of ISA forming, and me and Paul Price were involved in a whole bunch of committees with the whole how do you define architecture? And the one thing that we came up with that everybody could agree on was that architecture is what architects do. And then we needed to have another committee decide.
But then we have
who is an architect?
Architecture, software architecture.
Hold on a second. So I said, okay, so what is an architect? And after sitting down and having lots and lots of discussions of trying to define what makes an architect, the one solution that we all agreed on was architects are the people who do architecture. So I know it's a circular definition, but that's what we're left with. So ultimately, we have an undefined oriented way of doing something circular, which is why SOA became so popular, because ultimately, everybody could take the software that they just wrote and say, well, that's service-oriented right there. I've been service-oriented all along, and I just didn't have the words to describe it. Now, I personally don't agree with that philosophy, because it doesn't add anything. It's not useful. So when I look at the term service, I try to differentiate it from things that we already have. For example, if we look at something like a web service, whichever platform you're looking at, is a web service a service? Now, from a historical perspective, SOA, the architecture, was coined in 96, before we even had web services as a technology option. So that's number one. So it's kind of hard to say that a web service is by definition a service, because it was, you know, the term service was not meant to describe something that technologically didn't exist yet. But let's look at the relationship between service and web service. Now, if you look at a web service, you can think of it as a remotely callable object with methods on it. Thing is, we already had that. We had remotely callable objects even before we came up with the idea of services. The idea of distributed objects that you could get a proxy to an object and invoke a method on it, we had that. Architecturally, there was nothing new in web services. So to say that service-oriented architecture as an intentionally new architectural methodology, meaning that service was different than object, and web service being ultimately equivalent to distributed object invocation, one would say that a web service is very unlikely a candidate for a real service. And that already leaves people in kind of a little bit of a haze. So if a web service isn't a service, then what on earth is? Services aren't objects if they're not methods. What are they? And I find them very. I find the term bounded context, and we had a discussion about this earlier this year. Me and Eric and a whole bunch of other guys locked ourselves up in a room until we could all agree to disagree about the meaning of context. Right. So there's a ceasefire until next year. But I'd say that probably the best way that I could characterize it is that service, in my understanding and my use of the term service and service-oriented architecture, is when you have a bounded context that clearly aligns with a subdomain of the business. Okay. Now, in some cases, you have a subdomain, in other words, a decomposition of the problem domain that isn't aligned with the decomposition in the solution domain. You have multiple systems that have been built, whether they're on the same technology platform, different technology platforms, that overlap different business subdomains. That clearly is not a desirable situation for us to be in. Alignment is going to serve us a whole lot better. And that's one of the things that when SOA was talked about originally, talked a lot about IT business alignment. And you might have heard that term repeated several times, IT business alignment. So I'd look at it from the DDD perspective of subdomain bounded context alignment. So when you got those two things in alignment, then that can be an SOA service. That will lead you to IT business alignment and loose coupling and a whole bunch of things like that. That's my short answer for you.
So that's interesting. So first of all, I think I'm much less hard on SOA than you are, because I do think, so like so many of these things, it has been awfully distorted, and most of what people have done and said in the name of service-oriented architecture has been not really worth paying much attention to. I think you could argue
unlike domain-driven design.
Yeah, well, because domain-driven design never achieved the popularity that SOA did, it hasn't been distorted quite as badly. I think that's pretty much, you know, proportional to how popular a thing is. But it's been distorted in proportion to its popularity. Like, you know, Udi here has done his share. So now we, of course, we could argue, like with the architecture definition, that web services are services because it has the word services in the name.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a, I think, a workable definition of the de facto world of SOA. But when I go back to what I actually like about the idea of SOA, and okay, maybe this is not what most people mean, and you know, I might be just putting my own interpretation, but here's what I think of when I think of SOA that makes me like the idea. There are different ways of decomposing a problem, or different ways of thinking about what are those pieces. Object-oriented programming says that we're going to look at our problem, we're going to recognize that there are these little bundles of state and function that we bind together, and we say, we will construct our solution out of that. We'll construct our way of looking at the problem from that. And SOA says, let's look at it from different things that you would like to have done for you. So a service is something that you would like to have done for you. Now, to me, that's what a service is. And so a service then is a web service a service? Well, can it do something for you that you would like to have done for you in a way that makes the actual implementation of the doing of it completely, you know, completely encapsulated? And the answer is, well, sometimes it does and sometimes it doesn't. It really depends more, I think, on what the person who implemented the design the particular web service did, rather than all the machinery. I think if you had an object that has a method on it, but that method does something that you wanted to do in a way that makes you not care much about the nature of the object. You really just want to call that method and say, do this for me. That's a service. So to me,
so the small talk guys would say, no, that's a good object. All the people that were doing, you know, that had objects that required you to, you know, chit-chat with the object a lot to get anything done, they'd say, no, you're just not doing object orientation. You may be using an object-oriented programming language,
yeah,
but that's not object orientation.
No, I think that the kind of thing I'm describing as service that we wouldn't have called a good object, I think we would not have called it a good object, because the object doesn't reflect, it's not saying I am something. I don't represent some thing. I just, there's this method that you stuck on me. And yeah, you know, it's a pretty good method to call, but we never found a good place for it, a good kind of meaningful home. And I think when you, and you have a residual number of those kind of things, that there are things you would like to have done for you which don't represent things. Like, I don't know, I want my clothes clean. Now, I could make a laundry object, you know, a laundromat object, and call clean clothes on it. That reflects the implementation that we have for that service in the physical world. But really, if I could just say, clean these clothes, and the clothes would become clean, I don't care. On the other hand, if I've got, I don't know, a customer object. The customer object is about something. It represents some entity that I think exists in my domain. So I think they're different. I think services can be a nice way to abstract certain things.
So you guys want to go on this topic? Because, you know, I've got 5 days of material on this.
We're out of time. I wanted to ask you one last question, because we are out of time. This is a question we get quite a lot of times, which is in large systems, large applications, we usually have large databases and a lot of entities. And then some of those entities sometimes are used conceptually from different bounded contexts. So what is the way to handle that? I know there are several approaches, like separate ways, or shared kernel, or but can you put some light on it?
Well,
so for instance, I don't know, maybe in a, let's say we have an ERP and the customer entity is going to be used from many places.
I think that there is, of course, there are certain situations where you need to have an identity that is used, you know, like we need to be able to say when I refer to this customer by this ID that we all agree on that ID. But when we start talking about, let's say, having a database that has a lot of information about that customer in a particular schema, and we all use that, actually that's the sort of thing that I am trying to say don't do when I say bounded context. It that schema carries all sorts of assumptions and constraints with it, and when I'm over here trying to work on a certain problem, that database schema is simply not what I need. And so I prefer not to have those big shared databases where everybody's just reaching in. That's like the opposite of bounded context. Where's the boundary? How can I know the limit of the applicability of all my assumptions and definitions if everybody else is slashing around in there?
Yeah, I definitely agree with Eric on that one, but I tend to think that a lot of times our the entities that we come up with are, you know, the customer entity being just sort of the canonical example of domain modeling done too shallow. And then people tacking on create, read, update, delete on top of that entity. Yeah, as if customers would fall from the sky fully formed, and especially delete. But what does delete even mean? Did you shoot the customer? Do all their orders immediately disappear as well? You know, a lot of this stuff is just forcing a database-centric philosophy onto the business. When you look at the real business life cycle, often that's when you tend to see that data kind of comes into your system, you know, drip by drip. And you can model that happening in different bounded contexts. The first time somebody comes to your site, if you're an e-commerce type site, they're a visitor. They're not yet a customer, but it's interesting to know that, is this the first time this visitor has come to my site? Or is this the second time or nth time, in which case a cookie can help me figure out which things have they looked at in the past? They haven't bought anything yet, but they're still interesting. Then they added stuff to their shopping cart. Oh, okay, that's a different bounded context, the shopping versus the browsing area. Which things are in their shopping cart? How long have they been in there? Have they tried to check out? Have they stopped midway through? Again, they haven't bought anything yet, but there's a whole bunch of interesting data that can be modeled. Again, from an identity perspective, we want to retain the fact that it is the same visitor that is now doing shopping. Now, when they ultimately go and check out and they made their purchase, now we may have a real customer. Question is, well, what does the customer mean when you already have the shopping part that is handled in one bounded context and the visitor part that's handled in another bounded context? What is a customer when you've removed these other elements? And I don't tend to see a lot of that type of modeling happening when people focus on their entities, because they look at it from the assumption of, I know everything and everything is, you know, all the data comes to me fully formed, when a lot of the most interesting stuff is looking at the how does it trickle in, and modeling that from a bounded context perspective, you don't tend to end up with a big monolithic database or an enterprise canonical schema or anything like that. Yeah, once a customer makes a purchase, one of the most interesting things about them is the accounting side of it. How much money have I taken from this account? Have I refunded anything from this account? It's all about accounting, not about customer per se. Talk to the business, say, well, that's an account. We have a shopper, we have a visitor, and we have to keep all these things in sync with each other. But we tend to shortcut a lot of that and say, oh, that's a customer. And a customer has 300 fields on it. So it's, I'd say that starting from that place is very not domain driven in my perspective.
I agree, that's, I don't really have anything to add.
I just have a pet peeve with the word customer, I'm sorry. It's Northwind, I tell you. You've all seen that movie Inception, right? Who's seen Inception? Yeah. It's this idea virus that was planted in developers' minds when they were young. And they didn't know any better, and it took hold in there. And thought, this is the way that it should be. And there's never really questions, kind of buried so many layers deep. Customer order, order line, product. And every new system, we try to do the Northwind way without even saying it. Without ever realizing that, let's take, for example, waterfall. For those of you who don't know, the waterfall method was created and is an example of what not to do, okay? It was a methodology to illustrate all the things not to do on a software project. Now, somewhere along the way, the not got left out. And you say, oh, okay, this is the way to do software. And Northwind is kind of like that. It's a, the people who came together with Northwind, it's a dinky little sample application. You know, don't read too much into it. But it still has its effects. Everywhere I go, I still see that same style of approach being modeled. And I had this discussion with a couple of you over lunch. The idea that you could have a single entity encapsulate everything about something in the real world, whether it's a customer. Say, well, you know, why do we need to have a single class in our system to represent everything that there is about a customer or a person in the real world? Or the same thing about a product. You have stocking and warehousing information that is different from pricing information, that is different from, you know, visualization and presentation information. Why does all this need to sit on the exact same product object? It's, I have a theory about this. Unfortunately, we don't have the projector. So who of you have had a Swiss Army knife growing up? Swiss Army knife, yes? Usually it's men. The women don't tend to have it. So in case you don't know, a Swiss Army knife is a little knife that you can kind of fold stuff out of. Now, I had one of these growing up, and my theory is that a lot of people in software, and I've done this informal poll in a bunch of other places, a lot of software developers have had these Swiss Army knives growing up. And the more stuff that you had in your Swiss Army knife, the cooler you were as a kid. It was this feeling of power that you could, if you needed to, saw off something, start a fire with your magnifying glass, screw something in while building. Now, it was a myth, because even when you went camping, you needed a hatchet, you needed real tools. But having this idea that I could have in my hand, in one place, everything that I needed, we still see that in software. Trying to put everything in one place, falling into that same pattern, the silver bullet. You know, we keep trying, every time we say there is no silver bullet, oh, except this new one. Oh, and Service Bus is the new one, or Entity Framework is the new one, or Oslo is the new one, or whatever technology. Always grasping for a silver bullet, the one thing that will solve all our problems. But yeah, it's never worked.
But this time it will, because functional really is the silver
bullet. No, functional programming is the silver bullet. that's the one. Don't fall into that trap when doing your modeling.
Okay.